Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Tech Geek webinar series, our endeavor to empower techies. We believe that sharing of knowledge is the key to enhance our skills and grow us as professionals. With this principle in mind, we have initiated a series of webinars conducted by industry experts to give you all a crisp insight of various domains. The topic of today's session is Building Multi-Tenant Configurable High-Quality Applications for Any Cloud. This is the second session in the workshop, which is being conducted by Techcello. Our guest speakers today are Ms. Jyoti Rengarajan, Senior Technical Architect at Techcello, and Mr. Janaki Jayachandran, Practice Manager, Cloud SaaS at Techcello. Janaki is an ardent cloud enthusiast and a prolific speaker at NASSCOM and Cloud Connect even. He has 15 plus years of software development experience and was instrumental in defining the Cello architecture. Janaki enables enterprises and ISVs to define their cloud strategy. Our second speaker, Jyoti, has 12 plus years of experience in architecting cloud and SaaS solutions for both ISVs and enterprises. She is the chief architect in designing and constructing the Cello product. Jyoti plays consultative role with customers in implementing technical solutions. So without further delay, I introduce you all to our guest speakers. Over to you, Mr. Janaki.
Thank you, Mohini. Once again, welcome everyone. So in today's session, we are going to look at the following agenda. We are going to take a deep dive analysis on multi-tenancy. What does it bring to the table? And why should we even try to build a multi-tenant application or a product? We also look at some of the key decision parameters which would help you to decide if multi-tenancy is the right thing for your product or application. And then there are so many approaches, degrees in which you can support the multi-tenancy. We'll look into that. And followed by that, Jyoti will be covering two more NFRs today. That will be security and customization. So with that, I'll get started with the first session of multi-tenancy. So let's try to understand what actually tries to bring in multi-tenancy into the picture, right? So let's first try to understand the pain points around a normal way of doing things, and then we'll try to understand how the multi-tenancy is providing a solution to that problem. So let's take that you have your own product, right? It could be any product, any application. So you are bound to get customers, but when you get customers, you are also going to get various requirements from them. So the requirements sometimes could vary, and this is what typically the implementation phase of a product or application is going to contain, right? Implementing the specific requirements of the end customers. So in this case, let's take the first customer is coming and asking that, fine, I like your product, but then I want this particular form or a set of forms to contain my own specific set of fields. So your product doesn't currently have those fields, so I want to have them. Or it could even be that he doesn't want to have some of the fields which your product is already having. So either way is possible, right? And then another customer comes in, and then he says that the workflow that you are following may not work for me because my company's workflow is totally different. We have a very unique workflow in place. So you have to modify it and give me the product. That could be another scenario. The third scenario could be another customer coming in and saying that the business logic that you are using, for example, to calculate a benefit eligibility, it could be anything, right? It could be number of leaves available for an employee. It could be a sales commission logic, right? It could be any logic in the product. But the customer comes and says that the way we do it is completely different. Now, this is not a simple scenario because what happens is you can try to write your code generic enough, but in some instances, the requirements of these customers can totally vary as well as contradict each other, right? For example, the way you calculate benefit eligibility for one customer could be totally different and contradiction to the way you do it for another customer. So in this case, even though you try to generalize the product, generalize the business logic, it's not going to be feasible. And then there's another case where the customer asks that I want to have a very granular level of security control on the product or application, which means I should be able to determine who does what action at a granular level, say for example at a action level. So I can determine for my company which role performs what kind of action, and then I can determine or configure the system accordingly, right? So you end up in a real-time scenario having all these customers who are willing to buy your product or application, but then they're asking for these changes. They're asking for the product to be customized according to their needs. And the key thing is, if you're not customizing it, the customer is not going to like it. So you don't have an option as well. And given that your product, your competitors are willing to do this, you're obviously going to lose business, and hence overall it's not going to be a good picture. So what do you end up doing? You try ending up with customized versions of the product. So you take the product, you try to understand that particular customer's need, take a copy of your product, implement it for that customer so that you specifically set the fields he is asking for, you specifically set the business logic that they are asking for, right? You define a workflow very unique to the customer, load it all in that particular instance or the source code, and then you maintain these customized versions. So each of the customers are now getting the solution they asked for, but then from a solution provider perspective, is this the best thing you can do, right? Because as you could imagine, if four customers, fine, you can manage four different versions, but assume that you're going to keep adding customers, it's not going to be an easy job to maintain all these customized versions as well as keep managing these different versions. So what are the pain points? What are the challenges involved? So one fundamental challenge is the long implementation cycles. Because usually we say that the software cost already costs you so much, but then the implementation of it is also going to be taking up so much of cost. So one, from a value add perspective, from a cost perspective, it's not that attractive. The customer, while they want all these customizations, they hardly want to pay for it, right? So you also end up in spending long times of implementation. Sometimes implementation takes like 6 months, 8 months, depending on the size of the project and the customer. So in net, that it's not that attractive an option for value add to the customer. Uncontrolled breeding of applications. As you could see, you start multiplying these applications, so you quickly end up with a bunch of different versions of your product, which is going to be extremely difficult, and cost-wise, it's going to be very, very high in managing all these multiple applications, right? So you can take a simple example of a small release to be done. So you have to do it in so many different places. And more importantly, when you go for enhancements is basically you are adding more functionality. Because of these unique changes you have done for the respective customers, it's not going to be easy for you to do enhancements on these versions, which means you are going to either leave out these customers, they are going to stay with your old system, which means they are not getting the benefit of your further enhanced product. At the same time, when you have to implement these enhancements, you will have to go through a rigorous impact analysis in each of these versions to identify how these new enhancements are going to impact this customer, and then repeat the same steps as many times depending on the number of versions you're going to have. So any patches you want to upgrade, it's not going to be easy, because you need to talk to each customer. Each customer may have their own priorities. They may sometimes want to change it, sometimes they don't want to change it. So upgrading the product or releasing patches is going to be taking a whole lot of time, which means your overall operation cost is going to be extremely high, as well as the maintenance overhead involved in managing all these things. So you end up forming a larger support team managing this whole thing, instead of having your team focus on building more features. And overall, the implementation team is going to be heavily dependent, because they are the ones who have implemented it. They know the exact requirements and how it has been implemented. So your dependency on them is going to be extremely high. So this is a typical scenario we have when you have different customers asking for different customizations on a product. Now, Is there a way to handle the scenario in a much more easier way, in a much more organized way, right? So that is where multi-tenancy comes into picture. So in terms of multi-tenancy solution, the fundamental difference lies in building your product, not just with the functionality, not just a product, but a product which is capable of multi-tenancy, right? So you build your product with a multi-tenant architecture in place, which means the product on the architecture is capable of identifying all these customers through a set of settings. And these settings can contain the specific data about what the customer is looking for. For example, let's take the first case. This customer is asking for an additional field in an employee ad screen. Let's take an example, a field called hobby. So this customer settings information is going to keep track of that information. It's going to maintain that this customer X has requested for an additional field called hobby, and it has to appear in the employee screen. So assume that something can remember this and inform your product, or at the runtime can make your product add this field and display it only to that particular customer X, then you are achieving the requirement of that particular customer. At the same time, you don't have to worry about implementing it or changing it by customer. So tomorrow a different customer comes and asks for a different field, the same settings is going to keep track of this information as well and then render it only for that customer. So each customer is uniquely identified as a tenant in the product or application. So this is a capability, fundamental capability that a multi-tenant architecture provides you in the first place. Because the moment you are able to identify a tenant, then anything and everything related to that particular customer's settings are stored against that tenant's data. So this gives you a very flexible way of addressing these various customers' requirements in a generic way. At the same time, it's very specific and stored only to that particular tenant information. So that is where a multi-tenancy itself comes into picture, and multi-tenant product really helps in solving. So here, as you could see, it's no more multiple versions of your code. So all the challenges we saw earlier are going to be not existing right over here. However, building a multi-tenant product, of course, the architecture is going to be much more complex. You have to think through about a lot of things, how the multi-tenancy is going to be constructed, how do you visualize your business requirement and map it to a multi-tenant scenario. So all of that is additional work, but then building this multi-tenant product is going to be saving you a lot of time and money down the line over a period of time. So this is a typical approach between a single and multi-tenant scenarios, right? So like we saw the earlier case, the traditional model, so you see here the first two boxes, one and two, the top ones, they fall under the category of what we call as the single tenant. And the three and four falls under the category of multi-tenant. So in case of one, it's pretty much what we saw. So when you get a customer or a tenant, you take a particular copy of the software, you create an instance for that customer, do whatever changes you want to, and just deploy it for that customer. So you see in number one, you see a red color instance, a blue and then yellow. So what it means is you could have different code bases or source code being deployed for each of these tenants. Level 2 is slightly a better option in terms of maintainability. At least as you could see, the versions you are having, or the source code you are having, are pretty much the same. So at least you are not doing specific code changes. At least you are ensuring that the code still remains the same. Maybe you can try to keep it to an extent possible generic. And that way, through configurability, you can try to meet the customer's need. But the challenge here is the more changes the customers are going to ask, you are not going to be able to achieve it in the level 2. So you might end up in going back to level 1, right? So with minimal changes, there are not too many customization, level 2 might work for you. But when the number of customizations are increasing, then you will have to go ahead and modify that. So these two constitute the single tenant models. In some cases, particularly in case of SaaS, people do follow this model. It has its own advantages, we'll look into that shortly. But then from a maintainability and cost perspective, and particularly over a period of time, both these models may not be effective ones. 3 and 4, the multi-tenant models. The fundamental difference between these two are the capability to take up more load. So here in level 3, you are having pretty much one instance kind of a model serving multiple tenants. And the number of tenants you can serve could be varying depending on the hardware configuration, depending on the capacity you have. But from a source code perspective, you are trying to maintain one instance of your source code. And in terms of level 4, it's pretty much the same, except that it could serve a large volume of tenants. You're talking about, let's say, 1,000, 2,000 tenants, or even more than that. So when you're growing by that scale, which is possible in a SaaS model, where you are trying to address small and medium customers, SMBs, so it's very much possible you can grow to that extent. And the other scenario could be consumer-facing systems, consumer portals, or consumer-based applications. So where the end user, the individuals could be considered as a tenant, that's another case where the tenants' numbers could be pretty high. So in both these cases, so you have a single instance serving multiple people and the entire product being multi-tenant capable, which means it knows, detects which customer, which tenant is requesting for information, and then the whole thing works based on the settings for that particular customer. So looking at the factors between these four levels, how do these things vary and where exactly should I be concerned about? So some of the factors like operational efficiency, like we saw, it's going to be extremely low in terms of level one. As you saw, you just cannot maintain it so many versions in the first place. So relatively speaking, level one has a very low score on operational efficiency compared to level four, where the efficiency is going to be extremely high, because even if you take a small upgrade or an enhancement to be done, you are going to be doing it in either one place or in a handful of places, right? So which means it's going to be much more effective. Maintenance efforts, extremely high, level one, because you have to keep doing it again and again. Level four, again, is going to be very low maintenance-wise. Scalability, again, level one is not scalable at all as a model. You're going to keep spending on infrastructure, you're going to keep repeating things, so it's not going to be a nice model from a scaling perspective. Again, level 4 is more better compared to that. Time-wise, level 1 might take you less time to build or move to, primarily because you're not doing any changes over there. So you're not going to be spending time in terms of modifying anything, right? You take your functionality as it is when you are giving to the customer. But level 4 involves building a multi-tenant architecture in place, right? As I said, it does not come out of the box, but then you have to build an architecture which is multi-tenant capable, which can identify these different tenants and work accordingly. So it's going to take time to build that solution in the first place and then move your application or product or build your application or product on top of that. The transition cost, once again related to the time, is going to be quick and less cost compared to level 4. Level 4, again, because of the effort involved in building this multi-tenant architecture, the cost also is going to be high from an initial perspective. But again, from down the line, from a maintainability and operational efficiency, you're going to gain a lot compared to level 1. And in fact, some of the industry facts show that almost a multi-tenant application or a product, from an efficiency perspective, from a cost efficiency and operational efficiency perspective, can be 16x times better than a single tenant system. Now this is a very rough figure. Of course, this figure keeps changing from scenario to scenario, but from the project that have been done by some large organizations like MasterCard, the data that they have got is as much as 16x times. So that can give you an idea of the cost involved in the savings involved in a multi-tenant scenario. Engineering skill set, you don't need anything much in level one. It's just pretty much deploying it and providing access to the tenants. Engineering skill set is definitely required to build a proper solid multi-tenant framework for level four kind of scenario. Now the important point, the last point, is the customer value add. Now in this whole discussion, we did not talk about the customer, right? Because the very fact that customers are going to be accessing this final solution, they are one least bothered about how you are doing this, right? Whether you are hard coding it or you are changing it or you are doing it with multi-tenancy, they are not going to be bothered too much. That's the first point. And the second point is, this whole thing could be abstracted. For example, when you go for a SaaS, all the customer is going to get is a URL, and then based on a website, he's going to access the product, which means the customer may not even be aware of whether the product is working in a single-tenant model, level 1, or working in a multi-tenant model, level 4. So it's totally abstracted. So the fundamental point being, the whole multi-tenancy itself could be more helpful from an operational and efficiency improvement per se for the developer, for the ISV, or for the application provider, rather than for the customer. So how do I decide if multi-tenancy is the right thing for me? Right. So how do I objectively make that call? So this is a slide that has three columns. The center column represents the parameter involved in making the decision. And the text or the details provided in the left side indicate or incline a scenario which leads to a multi-tenant solution. Similarly, on the right side, you will see scenarios or answers which could incline towards a single-tenant model. So it's kind of giving you a feel of taking a parameter, trying to analyze that and see which one is best. Now, the end decision of whether you decide whether it's multi-tenancy or single-tenancy depends on the consolidation of all these parameters and, more importantly, the weightage that you are going to provide for each of these parameters. Because for some of them, it could be cost. Cost could be a very important thing, and hence you may want to give more weightage to that compared to for somebody else where they want to build a very scalable solution or they want to go for reusability of the current application. So you have to decide what weightage you have to give for each of these parameters. But then the point is you have to think through each of these parameters and see what works best for you, and then overall take a consolidated decision, right? So some of the parameters involved: the number of customers, the current and target, right? So one quick question is, as we saw, when the numbers are small, you could still manage with a single tenant model, right? If, of course, it's not efficient, a highly efficient way, but then when things are less, you can always manage with some kiosks. But then when the numbers grow, it becomes extremely difficult and almost impossible for you to do. So one question for you to ask is, how many customers do I have today? How many customers do I going to have down the line in 1 year, 2 year, 3 year, right? And then see if it really makes sense. So if I'm going to keep getting this handful of customers and not much, then maybe spending time and money in building multi-tenancy may not be a good solution. Rather, you may want to stick onto a single-tenant model. But most of the cases, particularly in SaaS, your customers are going to grow. Your business is expected to grow and grow rapidly. So you need to be better planned for handling large number of customers. The other constraints could be the engineering, the cost, budget constraints, and the time constraints. So as we saw, when you have constraints related to time and cost, better to deal with a single tenant. And some people do take single tenant as the interim solution as well. So they don't want to jump into level 4 straight away, particularly when you are dealing with migration related projects. When you are having an on-premise product and you want to move to, say, a SaaS model, many times you may move to level 2 first and then see how the traction and customers are getting acquired. And depending on the growth, you may decide to move to a level 4. So that is also possible. Likewise, market experimentation. Are you just trying to find out if SaaS is a good thing for you, whether even people would buy your product in a SaaS model? So those kind of things you are experimenting, no point in going for all out as a multi-tenant solution. And also, if you want to reuse your current app and you want to be just taking as it is what is there, or are you planning to kind of migrate it? Many times you may have a legacy product, a product which is written in VB or sometimes written in earlier versions of .NET 1.0 or 2.0, and you want to leverage the technology changes that has happened since then anyway you're going to re-architecture. So why not build it with multi-tenancy? So those could be the decision points and answers inclined towards that. Now, talking about the degree of the multi-tenancy, you could go ahead within multi-tenancy, you can go ahead and do it in different ways. So there are two primary layers when it comes to your application. One is the application layer itself, which is where your servers, application servers are going to be lying, like either an IIS server or Apache server, right? So that's going to be the application layer. And then you also have the database layer, right? So where your databases are going to be containing the data. Now, in the first model that we see, the complete multi-tenant model, it's a shared everything model, right? So it's the purest form of multi-tenancy we call it as, where your application and the database, as well as the infrastructure dealing with this whole setup, everything is going to be shared and everything works in a multi-tenant context, which means every layer identifies or is capable of identifying which tenant is requesting information and what should happen for that tenant. So what this means is your database could be, for example, employee table. The same single employee table can contain the employees of customer A, customer B, and customer C. Of course, you are going to differentiate those records through some unique identification, for example, a tenant ID column, which might represent whose record is this. So when customer A records are filled up, it fills up with the tenant ID assigned for customer A, and so on for customer B and C. So it's everything shared. Your application servers could be load balanced. You may have three load balanced servers, but any of these servers can serve any of the tenants. In fact, the first request of a tenant A can come to server 1, but the same tenant, the second request may go to third server. So everything is like tenant agnostic, so it can understand and exhibit accordingly. And the whole infrastructure is also shared. The second model is a slight variant to it. We call this a single tenant database. So here the application layer and the primary infrastructure is common, but then the databases itself could be different. This is done for various reasons. One, from a compliance per se, two, from a security per se, and three is there are some requirements where you will have to do some data related administrative operations like backing up of data and some security implementation within the data. So you need to be able to do these differently for different tenants, right? So you can do that only when you logically separate these databases. So you may have customer one stored in a separate database called customer one and customer two in a separate database. And the application once again is multi-tenant context. So as part of the settings, it also identifies which database should be connected to which customer. So once a customer requests, it goes and identifies which database is assigned for this customer and then operates on that particular database. So in this case, each database are going to have their tables, say employee tables separately, and appropriate records are going to be fetched. The third model is again a variant, but this time it's going to be on the application level. This is a very rare model, but in some cases it comes to help. So here the database remains common across all the tenants, but then the application layer is different. This could be done for reasons like you want to, for example, provide different size of hardwares to different customers. For example, one customer is a very small customer and only very few users are using it. You may want to assign a very small size hardware for them, right? So you want to put a low configuration system there because that is sufficient in that case. Whereas another large customer is going to be using with a large number of users and a lot of processing is going to happen. So you want a larger box there, a higher capacity processor, a higher configuration server in place. And of course, you're going to charge these two customers differently. Your small customer, you're going to charge according to the configuration you provide him, and the large customer is going to be paying more because he's using a larger server. So you will go for this model when you have scenarios of this nature. The other aspect is the tenant hierarchy itself. Multi-tenancy also provides you the capability of forming something called as a tenant hierarchy. So tenant hierarchy is basically representing the various customers in the form of an hierarchy. For example, let's say Microsoft is an ISV, is an application provider. So they provide, let's say, a fleet tracking system. So Ford could use it, GM Motors can use it, Chevrolet, Volkswagen. So each of this can be represented as a tenant. And each tenant can have their own set of end users used in the application. The simplest form of a tenant hierarchy. And this hierarchy need not stop at one level. It can go to N level. So you could have, for example, let's say it's a software, an accounting software. Best Buy US can buy. At the same time, Best Buy Canada can also buy, which means within the same company, it could be two different organizations or sub-organizations, delivery units that can use this. And each can have its own branches represented as tenants within the system. And they further can go to nth level of tenant. And you can have users in anywhere in this tree, right? You can have users at Best Buy US. You can have users at Seattle level. You can have users at the nth level as well. So this gives you a nice way of representing an organization hierarchy. That way, implementing the security norms and policies becomes much more easier. There is also this reseller model possible. So when you have a SaaS product, again, you may have resellers who would probably do white labeling, and they will sell it to their end customers, and then they kind of pay you a commission back to you, right? So a typical reseller model. So you could have, for example, have University of Pennsylvania act as a reseller for you, which means Pennsylvania itself is not going to use your product, right? Instead, it's going to be used by the colleges. So it could be distributed to college 1, 2, and so on, right? So it's a distributor, reseller-distributor model. And the virtual tenants are also possible. For example, when you want to group different tenants under a category, and then you want to apply settings to that category. For example, there could be hospitals available, and there are like long-term healthcare hospitals, and there is some emergency hospitals. So the settings you do, the workflow you have may differ between these two things. So you can create a virtual tenant, which means it's not a real tenant, but a tenant category kind of a thing, which can have all the settings in place. That way, when you get a new long-term healthcare customer, it's easier to add them under this virtual tenant, which means by default, they inherit all these settings, all the security access controls in place inherently, and then it becomes much easier to roll out the implementation for those customers. So where do I apply these multi-tenancy? We saw a few examples. To summarize, one, of course, for SaaS products, it becomes highly effective and highly required also, particularly when the product is growing. It could also be applicable to enterprise cases, where the enterprise has multiple locations. Like we saw, Best Buy Seattle is there, Best Buy Chicago is there. So Best Buy could buy this product, but then they want to implement it in different ways across the two geography locations they have. So it could be either geographical locations, or it could even be various business units within the enterprise. E-governance is another classic case. So you have so many states, even within India or US, you have so many states. So each state may implement the way they want to do things differently. So when a solution is implemented across the states, you want to give that capability for them to handle it differently. Platform BPO is another catchy term you might have heard. Once again, that platform BPO fundamentally operates under the multi-tenant context. BPO, as we know, they service different customers under different service lines. So when you want to do things differently for different customers, once again, the need of multi-tenancy comes in. And a few things like the hierarchical settings, where you need a hierarchical representation of an organization, once again, this becomes handy. And the country-specific solutions, as we saw, you may want to implement a solution in Finland, you want to implement one in UK, Scotland. So you want, again, represent each of these countries as tenant, and you can do these settings accordingly. So that brings us to the multi-tenancy part of it. With that, I'll hand it over to Jyoti.
Thanks, Chanaki. So in this part of the session, we are going to look at one of the most important NFRs again, which is security. So what's security and what are we trying to achieve as a part of this non-functional requirement? So it deals with the prevention of unauthorized action. So people who have access to do an action are only supposed to do it, right? So we are preventing a security breach or unauthorized access. And again, it's just not enough if we prevent it. We should also be able to have enough data points to detect or analyze if there was any try of unauthorized action breach. So we are trying to prevent an unauthorized action as well as log or instrument the data points that could tell us if an unauthorized action was about to take place. In addition to that, that application needs to ensure confidentiality and integrity of data. So if you have to achieve all these, so what is it required in your application or the product? So first thing that any product should be capable of doing is providing a role-based access control system. So this will obviously address the whatever we saw, prevention of unauthorized access. So what is role-based access system? So you have users in your application. So people who are supposed to do their actions should be able to do it, and the rest of them should be restricted to perform the same action. So this could be in any format. The roles are going to be different for various applications and for various companies. So according to the system's need, you should be able to bring in roles, bring in privileges, and totally orchestrate who sees what in the system. So that's role-based access control. From a data security point, we are trying to achieve the confidentiality and integrity of data. So again, this encompasses of storage and transit security. So we are talking about data security at two different points. One when it is stored and one when it is in motion. So we look at what are the techniques you can do to secure the data in both these modes. And we'll also very quickly touch base on the web security standard. So we have OWASP standard, which is the Open Web Access Security project defined common web security threats and solutions for that. We'll also quickly touch upon that. And then we'll also look at ways to instrument the data for security, right, which is what we call a security audit trail. We'll also touch base on what are some of the techniques you can use to have a very robust security audit trail system. So to begin with, role-based access control. The very first thing that you would need in your product is authentication. So basically, you need to authenticate whom the user is claiming whom he is or she is, right? So that is authentication. Now, kinds of authentication that you can have in your system are most common one, username, password-based authentication. So the user provides a username, password, and then logs in. You could also go in for a multi-factor authentication, so it will be a two or three level of authentication. Some systems also demand finger protection, or it could even need a sign detection and things, and so on to further authenticate the user other than just the username password. And you could also go in for a claim-based authentication, which is again a very normal or standard-based authentication. Like you could use SAML, which is the usual standard for claims. So one of these could be your way of authenticating the user. Now, where can the user identification information reside in a web environment? Especially, it could either be stored as an cookie or it could be in a session. So these are pretty much most likely used mechanism to store the end user information. And most of the technologies right now make it very simple. They already have a mechanism to handle sessions and cookie and so on. It's quite simple when you use technologies like .NET or Java and Ruby on Rails, which automatically provide these. Now, what's an identity store? Identity store has information on the authentication details. So either you could have your custom store, in which case you're responsible for maintaining the authentication information, could be your username, password, security questions, and so on. If you're having your own custom store, things that you need to take care of is properly securing your passwords, right? The passwords should automatically be encrypted and hashed and stored because it's a very sensitive data. You should definitely look at it. In addition to that, you should have policies for password reset, right? These are again additional security mechanisms that you have to take so that passwords are not easily cracked. So as if you have your own custom store, if you are maintaining the username and password of your customers in your database or data store, you're supposed to follow these two. Now, the other common mode of authentication or identity store is Active Directory, right? So if you are building an enterprise application, especially 90% of the time you would integrate with your LDAP or Active Directory in the enterprise or organization. So Active Directory again is a form of identity store. In addition to these two, identity federation also is a way of providing you the identity information. So what's identity federation? It's a mechanism wherein you federate between multiple identity stores to get the authentication information and or to validate the authentication information. Right, so we'll just very quickly look at the scenario here. So you could be on organization 1 and people from organization 2 could be using your system, right? Organization 2 could be your customer users who are going to access your system. In this case, you do not want to manage and maintain the authentication information of your customers users. So what you can do is you could trust your federation server, and the federation server can internally talk to your customers' identity stores and then automatically authenticate the information that is passed. So this allows you to very easily handle things like single sign-on. So federation also quite easily detaches your headache of handling all these different identity stores when it comes for different customers. So you could just pick a federation server and authenticate using a federated identity that would allow you to talk to multiple identity stores seamlessly. So you also have federation servers available from a lot of vendors, like you have ADFS, which is directly available with Windows. You have Azure Access Control Services available from Azure and Microsoft and so on. So you have a lot of single sign-on servers that you could directly install and use for your federation services. So these are the kinds of authentications you could do for your application and the stores or place where you could manage your authentication information. So once you authenticate, the next thing that you'll have to take care in your product or application is authorization, right? So authorization, as we discussed, is the ability to provide access only for the actions that a user is supposed to do and restrict access to the rest of the people, right? So what does it take to build an authorization? Usually people go in for a role-based authorization. So they say if it is admin, then give access to so-and-so menu, give access to so-and-so links and so on. So what happens is the roles in an organization or roles, especially when you're talking about a multi-tenant scenario where multiple customers are accessing your application, are totally different. So the roles could what you have as roles today could be totally different tomorrow, and you keep adding your own roles. Each customer would want to bring in their own roles. So the moment you base your access control on the roles, it's subjected to a lot of change. So the best thing to do here is to go for granular privilege-based controls, which means you break your system into features, and then the features you could further break down into privileges. For example, if you are building a CRM and if you have a customer management page or a customer management action, you could break your privileges like add customer, edit customer, and so on, which is more granular in nature. And when you code against the privileges and not for the roles. To be precise, when you are adding a customer, you check for a privilege if the user has a add privilege permission and not for the role, like if it is an admin allows him to do that action. So what this allows you to do is you write your code based on the privileges and then dynamically let the application add roles to it. You can maybe give a very simple administration form to for customers to come and add their own roles and map it to their privileges and map users to roles. So the moment you do that, once a user gets authenticated, the discovery of roles happen, right? For this particular user, what are the roles that he or she has, and once that is done, the privileges are automatically populated and the code works according to what privileges are available for that particular user. So this allows you to very very easily manage multiple roles of a customer, and if on a long term you would be able to bring in any kind of granular control on your product. So that's on authorization and the way you need to go about it. You could also, just as a point, you could also use claims, as I told you before, to add any additional authorization information. Now coming on to web application top threats, so you can watch out for OWASP, which specifically deals with web application security threats. And some of these things are the most top threats that are common across web applications. So man-in-middle attack, so this is a common threat where someone in between the network tries to seize information or alter the information. So the best way to overcome is simple. You use the HTTPS based protocol, especially when you have a secure data get transferred over the network. For example, password is a secure data, credit card information is a secure data, could be when you're entering a social security number, it could be a secure data. So all these things, when it is transferred across via, ensure that it is properly protected, at least at the transport layer, and hence use HTTPS based protocol. Now SQL injection is where the end forms or the end user input can be manipulated to do unauthorized actions on the SQL. For example, a form input could totally delete all the records, a form input could fetch all the records from the DB and so on. So you give an input in certain way, and if it is not properly validated, and if it's directly appended with the query, it might lead to some very adverse actions on the SQL server front. So that's SQL injection. So the way you can overcome is, obviously you need to validate all the form inputs before you process it in your queries. Now these techniques are quite become quite easy nowadays with the technologies like .NET. You just could use parameterized queries instead of appending or just going for a string based appending. You could pass on as a parameter, even for store procedures, if you pass on the parameters and then check that, these threats could be minimal. Malicious script injection and cross site scripting, so again from a user input, right, from maybe a form input, somebody could enter malicious JavaScript or malicious HTML information, and once that is processed could lead to adverse effects, right? So how do you prevent it? Again, you need to validate all the HTML inputs that are coming in, and when you are rendering it back, you use techniques like you escape the URL, you encode and decode the HTML back, and that will prevent the HTML from directly rendering and would minimize the adverse effects. So cross-site request is where some other site or robo users can try to manipulate your data or get the data or post back the data to your service. So the way to avoid is you can use techniques like CAPTCHA or a synchronizer token, which says that the request has in fact originated from this, from your server, and the request is from your server. So you could use some of these techniques to minimize the cross-site request threat. So coming to the data security. So when you are dealing with data security, you have two kinds of it. One, you are dealing with security of data at storage. And the next one, you are dealing with security of data while it is in transit. When you're talking about data storage security, encryption is mostly used technique to secure the sensitive data, right? So while for columns, let's say if I have a column called credit card number, or if I have a column called password, social security number, you will be encrypting the data and storing in your database. So the best technique to use here is a symmetric key algorithm compared to asymmetric due to its performance. And while you are encrypting, one thing you'll have to ensure is the key management itself, right? The key you're going to choose should be strong enough. You should be able to change your keys periodically. And where you store the key is also essential, right? Do not store the key along with the data, because a person who has access to the data should not definitely have access to the key. So you could also have double security mechanisms, like you could split the key in two different stores so that not a single person can have access to both the key storage. And you could also double encrypt the key sometimes, like, and again, both the keys should not fall into the same hand. So these are some of the techniques you can do to further prevent the key access to a to an unauthorized user. So it's just not enough if you encrypt. The idea is to keep the key also in a very stored in a very secure place, and also to have mechanisms to change your key periodically. Now, you could also go in for database encryptions generally, which are available in RDBMS like Oracle, which, and even on SQL, which completely encrypts the database, and you when you access, only when you have the right key you would be able to decrypt and then get the data access. So that will also prevent from unauthorized access of the data to a particular user. You should also watch out for performance when you're going for encryption, because it automatically adds its own overhead, and hence ensure you encrypt only the necessary columns and you do not just go about encrypting the entire data. So that's something that you need to weigh on, whether you need security or performance, and then take a call. Data security while on transit. So transit, we are talking about different points to point communication, right? So even a web application, we are first talking about web server to application server, and then end user browser to web server, and then application to database. So user browser to web server, the way to properly secure is using HTTPS connection. And for some data, you could also go in for custom encryption. Like you have, let's say, a social security number getting transmitted, and you do not just want to trust your HTTPS connection. You could again go in for a custom authentication, a custom encryption there. Now, from a web server to application server, that is mostly it's a web service call or a REST service call. So for that, you could use standards like WS security, which is for a SOAP. If a web service is based on SOAP, you could use techniques like WS security. You could use message security, which actually encrypts the entire SOAP packet and then sends. You could also use transport security with SOAP services, where the transport layer is encrypted. And again, you have techniques to authenticate the client. You could use claims again here, username, password, and certificates here. So that would actually authenticate who is the caller of the web server. So you could use all of these to authenticate the client as well as encrypt the data that is transmitted from one point to the other. On a REST, if it is a REST-based service, you could use HTTPS-based communication, or you could also deploy some custom asymmetrical encryption. Again, here, when on transit, the best form of encryption is asymmetric. We saw for storage, the best is symmetric, and for transit, the best is asymmetric. You could go on for a private-public key kind of custom encryption with REST as well. And you need to go in for a custom authentication. You could introduce authentication headers automatically in your HTTP request and so on. So that's on data security, especially when it is in transit. Now, we looked into how to secure the data on storage, how to secure it while on transit, but it's also very necessary to have a very robust security audit mechanism. So at any point of time, the application should be able to report any actions that are performed in the application, and it's very, very important for critical applications like finance or anything that is dealing with regulatory compliances and so on. So what should an event audit cover? So it covers these things: who does the action, what action is done, under what context is it done, and at what time is it done. So these are four minimal things that you have to capture as a part of event audits. So ideally it will have these parameters: subject of the action, target of the action, the context in which the action is taking place, user who is performing the action, and the date time at which the action is done. And also for performance reasons, it's better to store the audit data separated from your transactional database, so that the load and the volume of records of audit are going to be huge, and hence you can separate it out easily. And whenever you need a real-time audit, like you automatically need to fetch for every millisecond the audit information, if you have such a requirement, going for a audit cache is better. Now, to implement a security audit, you have again two different techniques that you could employ. One is a snapshot-based auditing, wherein every snapshot of the record is maintained, right? So when you are updating an information, automatically a copy of the previous state of the record is taken and the new one is updated. Now, when do we have to go for it? It's more suitable if your application needs past data as well. So it's just not for a postmortem, but you also are using it for reporting and so on. Then you could go in for a snapshot-based auditing. Now, the disadvantage of this is it leads to a huge data growth. As you can imagine, every row, every time it's updated, it's keeping a separate copy of it. So this could lead to a huge data growth. Now, data change log is where you capture only the delta of change. So typically what you would have the previous state of the column, the current state of the column, and when the change happened by whom. So So this is what you would be capturing as a part of change log. Now this is very handy when you're using the audit for security postmortem alone. So you, at any point of time, you just want to go and see what happened in your system. Then it's better. And if it's very difficult to process reports and other things with it. Like if you want to fetch your past data, this is not the way to go. But for a postmortem, it works well. Then the change logs are given automatically in provided out of the box in certain servers like or RDBM servers like SQL. You have a mechanism like change data capture. But so the advantage of it is developers need not write code for it, and it is automatically supported out of the box. So with that, we come to the end of security. So we what we looked at was we looked at authentication, different kinds of authentication, different stores of authentication, how you should go about designing your authorization. We also touched base on the web application security threats, and we also looked into the data storage as well as transit security. And then finally, we also looked at what you should consider as a part of security audit trail. I think we're running out of time, and hence we'll cover customization as a part of the next webinar. And we'll answer the questions right now.
Yeah. Please feel free to post your questions. We'll take up a set of questions, and then we'll try to answer them. Okay, the first question we have here is a person, Poonam Kambach, has asked, here in multi-tenancy, even a single patch is going to affect all customers. So won't it be more in terms of efforts? I believe you are referring going to affect all customers by means of maybe bugs or something. Now that's a positive versus negative thing, because when you have a bug, it's easier to just fix it once and deploy it, right? Instead of doing it with every single customer, that's a big pain. And moreover, the quality, improving the quality of the software, avoiding bugs is a totally different issue altogether. And that cannot be a reason why you don't want to choose a multi-tenancy. We have another question from Shankar Balasubramaniam. And the question is, why do we have two different words, customer and tenant, to represent the same entity, which is making us to think they mean different? It is different. Because like we saw, a tenant can represent any logical group of users within the system. Let me take a simple example. Assume Techcello wants to use a HR system, and I go ahead and buy an HR system. And I'm saying that if a user from Chennai logs in, he should be able to see the holiday list of India. Whereas a user from US is logging in, he should be able to see the holiday list of US, right? Now, you can achieve it by a simple if condition, but that's not the right way to do. In terms of multi-tenancy, you would create a tenant for, say, India, Techcello India, and a tenant for Techcello US, and you would store this information as part of that tenant settings, right? So here, you cannot call Techcello US as a customer, Techcello India as a customer, right? These are tenants, but Techcello as such is a customer. So that's why we use these two different terms, customer and tenant. So tenant is from an architecture technical perspective, a representation of a group of users. What is significance of tenant hierarchy? How it will be useful in SaaS? So I think we just saw that in the presentation. And so it basically allows you to represent a complete hierarchy of an organization right there, or a business model like reseller and so on. And it could also be very useful when you want to say consolidately look at various levels of data. Say, for example, you want to see it at a global level, you can see all the transactions. Whereas if I select at a, say, country level, then I can see transactions only of that particular tenant. So it also gives you that additional benefit. How do we maintain the tenant ID in DB table for child level or the nth level user? So from Suresh Kavili. So like you saw, tenant ID has to be stored. That is part of your architecture the framework you need should take care of that. So whenever you store data, you should ensure that the tenant ID is stored along with that. And this should be applicable at all entities which are tenant specific. We have a question from Vijay Kumar. Hi, can you please look at the typical architecture of the multi-tenancy application and how and where the tenant configurations are stored, etc. You have multiple options in storing the tenant information configuration details. Usually these are stored as part of the metadata information. So you could either choose to store this metadata information in the same database as you are storing your functional data, or you could keep it as a separate database altogether. Yeah, if you have any further questions, you can feel free to post it.
Okay, so we have a question from Prasad, which says, does privilege-based access complex as compared to client-based permissions? I suppose the question is, if you, instead of just checking against the client ID or role-based permissions, if you have whether a permission-based system is complex, it is not. In fact, it is very easy to go with a minute privilege-based system and then build everything on top of it, be it client licensing or role on top of it, and then your system can be easily maintainable also, and the effect from a development is almost the same. There is no difference in the development effort, the effect. How the multi-tenancy can be handled in code? This is one of the questions from Sachin. So the multi-tenancy itself, so you deal with configuration, you deal with the separation of data, right? The separation of data or data isolation can either be automatically handled as a part of your framework so that the developer need not have to specifically write code for it. So that could be one of the ways, or you could, the very simple technique is to go and append the tenant ID or the tenant's information in all your fetch queries, insert update, or be it cache related information and so on. But you could also automatically have it as a part of your framework that all the data are filtered directly while it is accessed using tenants. So that's an approach you could do as well.
We have one more question from Dinesh Kumar. Are there some standard frameworks available to help create multi-tenant applications? Yes, in fact, Techcello is one such provider of a framework. So we provide a .NET multi-tenant application development framework. In fact, the discussions we are having today and yesterday in the last session, these are all the various best practices that we have followed in building this framework, and that's what we are trying to share here. Share our knowledge through these sessions. You can find more information through our site, techcello.com. There are several other videos and materials that can throw a lot more information on the various architectural practices we have followed in building the framework.
Well, thank you so much for the insightful presentation. I'm really thankful to you for conducting this webinar. The recording of the session would be up on techgeek.com by tomorrow. Thank you all. Have a great evening.
Thank you. Bye.
Thanks a lot, everyone.